running entrance.
All right, we are starting. I am late. Sorry. Hey, did we even get us online? Was I keeping you from getting us? We're ready. We're live for you people who are at home.
Oh, he's so cute.
Welcome. We are. Yeah, you like the young man up there. Your son. Did you hear that? You're on live, and she said you're cute, Jet. So that's right. Whoever's behind the cameras, he's very cute, everybody. I like Jet. Doing a good job, man. Hey, okay, welcome to our 10:30 service. Glad you guys are here. Couple announcements that I want to bring your way. First off, is this card. You should be able to see them at the back table. I think they're at some of the offering tables, but grab one, and I want to challenge you this week to take one and invite someone to church for Christmas Eve. We've got a 4:30 indoor Christmas Eve. That's for you guys who you got to make it to grandma's house for dinner because you guys also open presents up on Christmas Eve. That crowd, I'm not going to say anything else. You know how I feel about that. After year, I keep saying this. Why can't you wait till Christmas? Why have to go the Christmas Eve route? And then there's the rest. There's the 6:30 outdoor service. So this is one we're trying. It's a whole new thing. But especially if you've got people who are a little more cautious, we went through and we were trying to meet some of our neighbors because, you know, we don't get to see them as often. And we told them, I think it's a big selling point, especially right now during COVID time, is outdoors, right? Just bundle up. It's going to be a little cold. We're going to have one heater. I think we're going to actually have a couple. Maybe we'll get one or two fire pits. It's going to be great. And so just enjoy our outdoor Christmas Eve service here. But grab that and invite somebody. Okay, I got another thing to talk about. Big announcement. I have forgotten for weeks to do this. But two things. So Jesse here, who is our worship intern, announcement number, yes, Jesse here. She's here, everybody. Now, announcement number one, Jesse graduated from GCU from the worship program yesterday. And so we're excited about that. But the 2 weeks thing I have forgotten to do is Jesse has already gone through Royal Palms 101. Jesse has shared her testimony with me, and Jesse has already been baptized at a church of like faith, and so Jesse would like to join Royal Palms. And so if you are happy and want Jesse to join with us, you say amen.
Amen.
All right. It's official again. We are in finally. But I'm glad Jesse's here. By the way, if you would like to join Royal Palms, if you've not done that, if you want to know more what it means to even be a member, January 10th, mark your calendars, January 10th, it'll be after this service. We do a 3-hour class. We provide lunch, but we talk about what it means to be a member, how to join. It's a prerequisite, too. So if you want to go and just know what we're all about and then what that all is, we'd love for you to just come hang out and just be with us. It'd be a good time. So let us know. You can come talk to me after service or online. We have a little link that we can put out for you, and we get the newsletter that way. But if you don't know how to do that, I'll talk to you after service about that. I think I got one more thing or two more things. I don't know anymore. Three more things. All right. Lottie Moon Christmas offering. Guys, we are more than halfway towards our goal. This is exciting. We set a goal of $10,000 that will go towards missions. 100% of it goes to the mission field. We are beyond the $5,000 mark now. So I know we can do it even during a time of COVID. I know we have blown these goals out of the water before. So pray about it. If you've not given, ask the Lord what you could give. This is on top of your tithes and offering. This is something special that you give separate towards missions. And it's incredible. I got to tell you what this does. I grew up on the mission field with the International Mission Board. As a child, my parents never had to go home to raise support. Other missionaries I knew, support they had to raise all the time, having to go. They didn't know if they could stay on the field. They didn't know how they were going to make it. As a Southern Baptist missionary, we went, and we never had to worry about that. We were able to do the job, and Lottie Moon Christmas offering is one way that we help continue to do that and take care of our missionaries. We're going to send one of ours out in about 6 months, too. Matthew Pilkington is going to go as a journeyman, and he's going to go and not have to pay a cent because we are going to be able to, through churches like ours, supporting Lottie Moon and IMB, be able to send him and him be able to do his two years out in the bush somewhere as a missionary. So that's incredible. Think about how you can get involved with that and to give. Okay, last thing. This was it. I did have one last one. If you were a member of Royal Palms, I knew this connected to you somehow. If you were a member of Royal Palms, like Jesse has become today, we are voting for deacons. And that all that is these are men who have actually been deacons before, and this is to allow their term to start to serve another 3 years coming up. So if you will, later on today, go by the offering boxes. There's a little card like this. Check the names, write your name down, drop it in the offering box, and then we're done. And then we will collect those and see if people like Curtis Clark or Chris Kendall or Ed Reimersma become deacons again, which these are cool guys. So I think sure hope they do. I like them. All right, let's pray, and then we're going to get started. We need to. I'm done talking. All right, God, thank you for this morning, and I thank you for the people that you have gathered together here. Lord, I know that there's a lot of there's a lot of things going on in our lives, a lot of stuff that doesn't even feel like Christmas season sometimes. It just feels like we're rushing through. Can't believe that Christmas is going to be here this week. God, I pray that while we're here today that we would hear you clearly, that we would walk with you today, Lord, and that we would hear everything we need to hear in order to be filled up and then sent back out into the world that you've called us to. God, I pray that you'd be with us during this time. Help fill our hearts with praise for you. God, I pray that you would speak to be with those children who are next door in Children's Church. Be with the Burundi and the deaf church that are meeting on this campus right now. God, I pray that you would use them to reach others in their community as well. We pray these things in your name. Amen. Hey guys, let's stand up and get ready to worship the Lord now.
Technically a Christmas song, but I vote that we make it one because it's perfect. Today is Love Day on the Advent candle, and I didn't even put that together. So it's really cool that this song is one of my favorites, but it's called Love Came Down, which there's no better way to imagine that than Jesus coming to save us. So Merry Christmas.
Overwhelmed, and I cannot hear your voice. I'll hope, and every promise comes my way. When I feel your hands of grace rest upon me, staying desperate for you, God, staying humbled at your feet, I will lift these hands in praise.
This last one, I didn't want to, it's always prayer time, okay? Always. But I didn't want to specify that this time. This one is another one of my favorites because I'm being very selfish today. but this line in particular, you have made a way here. You have made the way clear. You have come to save us, Lord. I think a lot of times out in the world, they like to say, well, God will make everything okay. It'll all get better. It'll be fine. And that's true. He will make it all okay in the end. But he didn't save us from hardship. And I hope we know it. And Ben's actually going to talk about that today. But he did make a way, and he made it clear, which is by far the best Christmas present ever.
Lord of all worlds, light of the world, you shine.
Father, we lift up your name today. Jesus, we thank you so much for what you've done for us, for the path that you made. You didn't get us out of all of this hardship, but what's even better is that you got us out of here eternally. And with you into your presence. And we praise you for that this morning and for this season, that we'd remember what happened. God, we thank you for the words we're about to learn in Scripture and what you have to teach us. And we love you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Now I'm on. There you go. Can I get the French family to come on up? And while you just got comfortable and sat, let's stand, ha, again. I like doing that to y'all. But you know the drill. That's how it goes sometimes. We get started and we're just going to stand because we are about to read the scriptures. But as the Frenches are coming up to do this, we're in season of Advent. So we're actually going around. Magically, they got bigger again. Remember, so you guys have seen, they've just... It's a miracle. So here we go. We've been going around. And the point is, as we light these candles, they're driving us closer to where we want to get to the center into this candle. It's just to show us that Jesus has come, to mark the birth. And so here we are as we go through, and each one means something. But it's helpful, right? Because we're in a busy season. For many of you, I don't know if you're as shocked as I am that say, wait, it's Christmas this week. My kids they're building up. They know it's Christmas this week. But for the rest of us, you just kind of go through the week and you're like, oh man, we're already there. And so this is a cool thing to do, is just to pause. As we do it, we get a chance to read the words of Scripture and get to focus on the story of Christmas. And so today's is called the Love Candle, because here's what we're showing. This is not a showing of God just saying, hey, I wrote it in the sky, I love you. I mean, good to think about this. God, looking down at a depraved humanity that we are, could have just said, yeah, here, love you. You guys are cool. But that's not what we see in the gospel. We see in the gospel that God loved us so much that he was willing to now give his one and only son to die in our place, to then give his perfect record to us to make us go free and to get to live with him. That's an incredible act of love. I could never do that. But God did it for us. And so we're going to read the scripture today for us. And so as you hear it, just think about what that means and the joy, the love of God and what he's doing as he brings this in and ushers this in.
All right.
Go for it, Joy.
So today we're reading Luke 2, verses 8 through 20. I cried in the first service, so I'm going to try not to cry the second service. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy, and that will be for all the people. Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. This will be a sign to you. They will find a babe wrapped in clothes and lying in a manger." Suddenly, a great company of heavenly hosts appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men whom his favor rests." When the angel had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the babe, who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds had said to them. But Mary treasured all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had seen, which were just as they had been told.
It's interesting. We're going to go ahead and light this, guys. And so I'm going to ask the French family, go ahead. Here is your, which one of it, you could all do. There's four of you. There's four candles. We could do it however you want to do it. But we'll start with this one. But here we are. We are getting to see that this is not just that a baby was born. Sometimes we talk about Christmas as if, you know, a baby was born, but babies are born all the time. But this is really the unfolding of God's loving plan for humanity. And this is why people are as excited as they are. And this is why the church should be as excited. Wrong order, Mitchell, but that's okay. It's okay. I'm going to call it out. It's okay. You know what? You know what matters is we're getting to this one. We're fine. Man, I love you. You're such a good guy. All right. Thank you guys for that. Let me pray. That's why I love having families up. I get to do this with the family. Good man. You're fine. You're good. All right, let me pray. God, I thank you for this church. God, I thank you for families that build up this church and getting to do this together. God, what a heritage to be able to see this too, though, a family, Lord, that is a, this is a, we have generations that have been in this church now of faith that have come from this one family too, getting a chance to light these candles today. God, I thank you that as we are here celebrating Advent, that our focus is on you. Our focus is on this incredible news that we should not celebrate this story as if you just popped up on the scene and that was just a birthday, but this is the unfolding, the incredible unfolding plan of your love for humanity and a chance to redeem us, bringing us, for those of us who trust in you. God, I thank you. And we pray these things in your name, Jesus. Amen. All right, guys, thank you for helping out with that. It's all good. You're fine. You're good. You know what? I got to tell you this. Hey, Gabe, I'm going to go without this. My thing's going to die. It's just not working. So no PowerPoint. It's all good. What are we going to do prior to the days of PowerPoint? You will make it. So here's the deal, though. Many of y'all, if you've seen the pastures, we've done it out of order. I'm very particular. I want it done the right way. So sorry, Mitchell. All right. Hey, a couple things before I get started. First off, you can't really see it now, but this is a little luminary. And so these are ones we have our special friends class, our special servants class are making these. If you would like them, they've got 12 for $10. All of that goes towards youth winter retreat. You'll see them at Christmas Eve. We're going to have them lined up. It'll be really pretty to see. But these are great little ones if you want for your driveway or for outside. But I'm going to put this down here for you to get to see it. If you'd like one, just let us know, and we'll put an order in for that Sunday school class that does that. All right, here's what I need you to do. Open up your Bibles to Daniel chapter 12. We are finishing Daniel, Royal Palms family. It's going to happen today. It's going to be awesome. It's a great book. I got to tell you, I did not anticipate that I would have this much fun going through this book. But this book is really, as we get to the very end, is focused on the very end of days. A question for you I'd like to ask is, you know, think about what you would do if you knew the end was coming. What would you do? What would you change? For some of you, I already know what you would do because you've already lived through a few of these already, right? Granted, the fake ones, right? I remember Y2K. Any of y'all remember Y2K? What did you do for Y2K? I know we had a freezer full of stuff stored up because the computers were going to shut down and it was going to be a Terminator scenario where they took over, and next thing you know, I remember 1999, December 31st, watching everything take place and realize that once China got the new year, we were okay. Everything was, they got the new year first and everybody was fine. But we still had a lot of food left over. Think about the next big one, by the way. You know what I'm talking about, the end of the Mayan calendar. December 21st, 2012. I remember for weeks having conversations, you know, in middle school about, you know, the end of days is coming. The Mayans predicted it. It's on the calendar. The calendar shuts off December 21st. And stories go, by the way. I was reading a story in preparation for this. A guy in China actually built his own ark to get ready, because the way it was supposed to be is there's supposed to be incredible, like, turmoil in the oceans, and everything was going to get wiped out. So he built an ark. One dude built an ark but ran out of money halfway through, and so he had half an ark. But now they're tourist attractions. But people really did a lot of stuff. If you look at stats, everybody stocks up on food, stocks up on guns. But here's what's really fascinating to me. Found out, did a little digging. There are some who say we read the Mayan calendar wrong. It's not here yet. You know when it is? Because we've done some dating wrong, some calendar issues. The real end of the Mayan calendar is, you ready for it? December 21st, 2020. Tomorrow is the end. I mean, after going through 2020, you're kind of like, well, maybe. It could be. I don't know. Could be. But I know all y'all think, if it's tomorrow, I got a whole list of things I need to make sure I'm doing, right? So here's how I'm going to end this. Here's what we're going to do. Hallmark film, you and me, PJs, curled up, eggnog, and then right at 11:59, I'm going to give you a big kiss. Because if it goes out like that, if we're done, at least I leave this world kissing my beautiful wife, Diana. And that's it. That's all I want to do. I was told, so I said this, I've told the other service, my old pastor who I used to serve under, every time he mentioned his wife or his daughters in a service, they got a new outfit because he used them so many times in illustrations to the point like, Dad, we can't do this anymore. And so he would always watch himself like, oh, no, there's an outfit. And so I made the comment in first. I said, I don't think I've made that deal. And then I was reminded, no, I think you have made that deal. And then I just said something to her before. I said, I think I'm going to have to talk about you. She goes, well, I'm getting an outfit. And I said, I don't have anything in writing. So there is no writing. There is no paper. It's not written out. No outfit. Sorry. Okay, one outfit. All right. But if tomorrow ends, you don't need one. So, ha, we're done. Or I'll just be a Christmas gift. I planned it ahead of time. So, but anyways, as you want to think about this stuff, what I want you to think about is, you think about, like, we all respond in really, really weird ways to knowing the end. And it should change in some. If it really was going to end, there should be things you would want to do. There's a deal, though. We watch those things, and the internet is without, I mean, there's always a conspiracy of when the end is coming. And a lot of the time now we're at a point like, yeah, who cares, whatever. And we don't really even think about it. You might do a little bit of prep. You're just a little bit nervous about things, you know. But for the most part, we don't really think about it that much. Now, when we get to the book of Daniel, we are talking about the end of time. In fact, when you remember in chapter 11, verse 14, he says, this is about the end of days. Now, what's interesting too is Daniel, if you read through 11, it is extremely precise about how the world is supposed to fall, you know, how the world history is playing out. Daniel, who's prophesying in the 500 BC time frame, is going through 300 years of history, and it is precise. And so here's what we need to know is he was super accurate in the information that he gave throughout chapter 11, and now he makes the big jump to now we get into the end of time. And so we can trust that it was very accurate there. We can trust that what he's been saying and the information he's been given is going to be accurate for us now. And so Daniel, who is hearing all of this, is going to ask the question that you and I all want to know is, so when is this taking place and what should I do about it? And so that's where we find ourselves today. Let me open us up in prayer, and then we will begin to take this passage on. Heavenly Father, I thank you for this text of Scripture. And I just pray, God, that you would work in our hearts, be able to hear you clearly. God, we live in a time of really uncertainty, and Christmas has been a great time of just having a little bit of relief from some of the chaos of the world. But the truth is, when we're done with thinking about lights and presents and some of the traditions, we get back into a world filled with chaos. And God, I pray that we would just spend this time and recognize what it is you want us to know as we take on this passage today. So we pray these things in your name, Jesus. Amen. All right, so look at verse 4, and let's read through what it says. So just in context, all of 11 is the vision. It's all about everything that's supposed to play out. And so here we are. It ends, and now verse 4 picks up with these words. But you, Daniel, keep these words secret and seal the book until the time of the end. For many will roam about and knowledge will increase. So that kind of seems like an odd phrase, right? Because Daniel, you've been given all this information. You've been told about how the world's going to play out. There's information about the Antichrist and how the end is going to come and what he's going to do to God's people. You're told about the resurrection, the bodily resurrection of God's people that's coming. And then at the very, he's like, seal it up, keep it secret. Now, the English words don't really help us here. It's really not that helpful. It doesn't really sound good, but here's what that actually means. In ancient times, to seal up something was actually to preserve it. In fact, these words really don't necessarily mean, I mean, sure, to seal it, to keep it secret, but what it would have meant culturally, what it meant historically was write it out, seal it up, and keep it for preserve it. And you actually see this if you look at Jeremiah 32. He does this. There's an agreement that takes place, and they have to seal up this document. But what would have happened would you would have a document, you would make a copy of it, and then you would seal up the original and preserve it. Who knows if the original manuscript maybe made it into some Persian archive somewhere. Who knows if maybe that's part of what the Magi have got when they come up and they show up on the scene as they've been studying the original. But what that meant is keep it, preserve it, and that's what it's for. So it's for another time, as we'll actually find out. That preserve it, but it's for the future, okay? Now, it also says many will roam about, knowledge will increase. And if you have been taught like me growing up, typically these verses are used to say, see, in the future, people are going to be traveling all the time, fast all the time. And then knowledge is going to be increasing, which is true, but that's not what actually this means in context. The words many will roam about, it's a word of meaning roam, but looking for something. It's intentionally looking for to discover something. And in context, it seems to be talking about how these prophecies are actually going to be fulfilled. And then also you'll see, and knowledge will increase. It appears to be talking about knowledge of how this stuff is increased. Because in the rest of this passage in context, the people who have knowledge, who have understanding, are the people who know the scriptures, who have been walking with the Lord, who are able to recognize what's happening around them. And so it appears that what he's actually saying is, seal it up, but in the future, people will begin to understand better. They'll be able to look back and be able to kind of see how this has all played out and have a better understanding of what this is meaning. So this is important. This is not talking about a futuristic time period where of just saying what the conditions will be like, but this is talking about the future, that people will now have a better insight to look back. We are able to read the previous set of chapters of Daniel because we are from the privileged perspective of knowing history. Daniel's writing, and it's all future. No one really knows how that's going to play out. We are able to go backwards and say, yeah, look at how it all plays out bit by bit. And so that's what it's talking about there. Now, look at the next piece, verse 5. Then I, Daniel, looked, and two others were standing there, one on this bank of the river and one on the other. So here's what it seems to take place. I'm of the opinion that whoever he's been talking to, Gabriel maybe, I think he's gone. I think he just it finishes up, leaves, and he's back now helping Michael fight the prince of Persia like he talked about in chapter 10. Okay. Now, here's what else is interesting, though. The vision goes from, let me tell you about the future, to now it goes back to the visual part of the image. And now he's back at where we see started in chapter 10, where it says he was on the banks of the river. And it says in verse 5 of chapter 10, I looked and there was a man dressed in linen with a belt of gold from Uphaz around his waist. His body was like beryl, his face like the brilliance of lightning, his eyes like flaming torches, his arms like feet that gleam of polished bronze, and the multitude of his words were like the sound of a multitude. It's when he sees him, he has no energy in his body left because he's actually seeing the glory of God. He's seeing who I believe this to be, Jesus Christ himself. So notice, he's gone back now, and now he sees Jesus again. And there's two guys with him, one on one side of the river and one on the other. And it says that there's there, and one on the river, and the one, there's the other guy who was, it says, one of them said to the man dressed in linen who was above the water of the river. So the image is there's two guys, and they're two angels, and Jesus is hovering over the waters. Now, in the Old Testament, those who controlled the waters, that was God, because the waters are chaotic. God controls it. And so here's another image of who this is. He's standing above the water. Isn't that interesting that Jesus will stand and walk on water later on? But here's another thing. I said, why two guys? This is just me. This is paint speculation now. There's no confirmation. So if you take this and say this is valid, because my pastor said that holds about as much weight as just my opinion on something. So there's two guys, and I think, isn't that interesting? There's two guys with Jesus, or there at the resurrection, the book of Luke. Maybe those are his two friends who like to hang out with him. Maybe that's who's at the image with them, one on one side, one on the other. They're just talking to him. I don't know, but I like that. I'm going to keep that, and that'll be what I want to believe there. but there's not much more past that. So I could be totally wrong. But here's the other thing. He says, so he's there, they're talking to him over, and notice what these angels do. Because they're asking him a question. He's different from the rest. This is another reason why I believe this to be God. This is Christ. How long until the end of these wondrous things? So they're asking him, they're saying, hey, how long is this terrible stuff supposed to take place? That word wondrous, by the way, that's the same thing that was said in chapter 11, verse 36, talking about the outrageous, terrible things that were going to be said by the Antichrist. So essentially what they're asking is saying, how long is all this terrible stuff supposed to take place for? Once again, these are angels asking God. They're asking him, hovering. He has the answers, they don't. Which is interesting to think. Why would an angel not know the answers, right? Aren't they? They're spiritual beings. They should know these things. And it does seem to be that they don't know everything. The gospel, Peter tells us in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 12, talking about angels. He says, it was revealed to them that they were not serving themselves but you. These things have now been announced to you that through those who preach the gospel to you by the Holy Spirit sent from heaven. Angels long to catch a glimpse of these things. So it could be that they literally don't know. They're interested, just like we are, of how long is this supposed to be? How long is the Antichrist going to crush the people of God? How long until the resurrection of the dead comes? And that's the kind of thing they're asking him. Now, it could be that they know, and this is for Daniel's sake. They're asking Jesus a question so that Jesus will then answer and give that to Daniel. And then it says this, verse 7. Then I heard the man dressed in linen who was above the water of the river. And he raised both hands towards heaven and swore by him who lives eternally that it would be for a time, times, and a half a time. Now here's the image. He if you were to make an oath back in the days, and you remember, we even see this in courtrooms, you put your hand on the Bible and you raise a hand. Here he is. He's raising not one hand, he's raising two to show the gravity of the oath that he's making, to show that this is as sure as can be. You need to know that I know. And by the way, it seems like he's swearing upon himself. To himself, I'm telling you everything you need to know right now. And here's the answer he gives. This will only last for a time, times, and a half a time. Now, we've heard that phrase before in chapter 7, talking about the Antichrist who was going to come out of the fourth kingdom. And it says he'll speak words against the Most High. This is chapter 7, verse 25. And oppress the holy ones of the Most High. And he will intend to change the religious festivals and laws. And the holy ones will be handed over to him for a time, times, and a half a time. Meaning 3.5 years. 3.5 years is how long this is going to last. He says this, that it would be when the power of the holy people is shattered and all these things will be completed. Meaning that it'll take 3.5 years, but what's going to happen is he is going to shatter the holy people, God's people. Now there's a purpose for that is what it's going to say. And what we'll find out in this, but it's going to be a 3.5 year period. Now this is something important. 3.5 years, it's not forever. Shows that God is in control. He's determined even the time frame of this. But you might ask the question, what is this for? Why? Now, there's a big question we need to answer before we jump into this, which is who is going to be shattered? Who is going to go through this great tribulation period? And as I referenced last week, there's a big debate. Is this the church or is this the people of Israel? And as I've been going through Daniel, guys, I have been challenged all the time on my views of this. You want to have your views challenged? Just read a book straight through, verse by verse, and you will find there's sometimes I'm here, sometimes I'm there. But here's kind of where I'm landing now. It does appear that when you read in this text, beginning in chapter 10, verse 14, he tells Daniel, I've come to help you understand what will happen to your people in the last days. For the vision refers to the last days. This very well could be speaking of specifically Israel. That the point of this is something that God is going to have the people of Israel go through. Why? Well, Jesus seems to make it clear that one of the reasons why in Matthew 23 is he says, I tell you, you will not see me again until you say, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. It could be that this is for Israel so that at the end of a 3.5 year period, they will finally drop the scales from their eyes and call out to Jesus as Messiah. We know from Romans chapter 11 that God still has a plan for the people of Israel. So is this that? It could very well be, though, that when Daniel is told it's for your people, he's just meaning collectively the people of God, meaning the church and believing Israel that will come in during this time. But it could be that this is for Israel. Now, we're going to talk more about this as we go a little bit further, but what we find out is it's going to be very terrible, but it will be done. It will not last forever, and that should be helpful for you. Because recognize that God will shut it off when he's ready. It has a purpose and he will let it play out, but it's going to be done when he's ready to be done with it. Now notice what else it says in verse 8. And I love verse 8. I heard but did not understand. Y'all said that could have been, I agree, Daniel. I'm glad that Daniel puts that in there, right? Because I think that most of us are like, yeah, I would say that's about true. You think about this, he's had everything that you and I have read. He's had more. We've just had, 12 chapters to read. He's had his whole life walking with the Lord, seeing stuff. And yet at the end of this, he's like, I still don't quite understand. There's been a part of me that for a long time, I didn't want to deal with biblical prophecy. Because you get to a part where you're like, I just don't understand. I mean, I've got lots of people that they've got charts, big charts of how all the end time stuff is to play out. And then I would read and I say, but I didn't see that chart in my Bible. Like, how did you do that? And then you feel like inferior because you're like, my chart doesn't line up with your chart. And so it's okay, though. Some of it's not easy to understand. And it's okay if you don't understand it and grasp it. Doesn't mean that you don't study it. It just means that it's okay to not fully get it all the time. Now, Daniel says, I don't understand. And notice the answer, what he says. So I asked my Lord. He's asking Jesus, what will be the outcome of these things? And essentially, the way that should be better translated is, how are all of these things going to come to an end? He's asking, okay, I see this 3.5-year thing that you're talking about, but he's saying, how does that come into play? Meaning, like, how long till this takes place? What are the events that are going to take place before that all comes about, right? Well, notice the answer. He said to Daniel, he said, go on your way, Daniel, for the words are secret and sealed until the time of the end. A couple things there. First off, that's almost the exact same thing we just heard in verse 4. They're secret, they're sealed. But he says it's for the time of the end, meaning it's for those who are living in that time. They'll get an understanding of it. They'll know. But you, Daniel, go on your way. That phrase means, Daniel, you just keep doing what you do. Essentially, he's saying, Daniel, that's none of your business. Don't worry about that. Being nice. I mean, the angels have asked. He's not rebuking him for being confused, but he's just saying, don't worry about that. That's not for you to worry about. We're going to hear more about that in just a second. But he says, don't worry about that. This is for another time. This is for the time of the end. But he's going to answer still. He's going to give him a little extra information. Notice what he says. Many will be purified and cleansed and refined, but the wicked will act wickedly. Now, let me stop here because these words, purified, cleansed, refined, are the same words that are used for the people of Israel as they went through the story of Antiochus. So if you go back and try to remember the story of Hanukkah, and it's actually included in Daniel chapter 8, it's included in chapter 11, but the story of Hanukkah is the Greek king Antiochus Epiphanes, Antiochus IV, comes to play in Syria. He's over this whole area, and what he wants to do is stomp out all of Judaism. But we find, as you read chapter 11, we're told about a group of people that were going to remain strong through it all. But even so, they remained strong with the Lord. It says about those people in verse 35 of chapter 11, for some of those who have insight will fall so that they may be refined, purified, and cleansed until the time of the end, for it will still come at the appointed time. Meaning that people are still going to experience persecution. Purified means to be cleansed morally, purity. Cleansed is to be made, to be made white, to get rid of the impurities there. Refined is like refining metal there, getting rid of that. But the image is that people will go through that and it will strengthen them. It will purify the people, it'll purify the church. Get rid of those who are not really part of this and really, really boil down to cleanse the church, his people this way. Now, what's interesting about this is he's talking about what's going to lead up to this time. And he's going to say is that it's going to be bad. In fact, the people of God, the same things that happened to the people of Israel during the time of Antiochus Epiphanes when they went through an extreme time of persecution, that's going to be happening all the way up until the very end. So here's what you need to know. Whether you are a post-trib person, a mid-trib person, a pre-trib person, meaning you don't know, is the church taken up? Is it just Israel that goes through the tribulation? Or is it the church that goes through? Regardless, one of the things that we all can affirm is that it's saying is that the church will be experiencing persecution all the way up until the end. In fact, he also says, and the wicked will act wickedly, meaning people are always going to be wicked and they're going to continue to be more so. In fact, Paul affirms this in 2 Timothy chapter 3. He says this in verse 12 and 13. In fact, all who want to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. Evil people and imposters will become worse, deceiving and being deceived. So one thing we can affirm is that the course of the future is not one that gets brighter, but is one that is going to be worse. And that shouldn't shock us. And the church is not exempt from that. The church is going to go through rough times. Whether that means we go through the big, big one, the big tribulation, the great tribulation, or it's just Israel, regardless, we're not exempt. If you just read stories this week of what's happened to the church worldwide, you will understand. We are going through, in America, we're barely in anything. When you think about the rest of the world, it is hot. But it's to say that it could be worse here. It's probably coming here at some point in America. But recognize that that's just the way that this is going. It's always headed that way. We do not see a theology from the text to say, well, it's going to get much better before Christ. No, it's going to get much worse. But here's what you need to do too. Because there's a cynical way that you can go about this. If you've been like me, if you're like me, what happens is this. Well, it's all going this way anyway, so who cares anymore? I'm just voting for chaos now, right? Yeah, I've got relatives like this. It's all going off the rails. It's all going to hell in a handbasket. So just buckle up and get ready and enjoy the ride. You know, just that's just my relatives are like this, right? We're just gonna watch the world burn. Okay, that's not the point. The point is just to recognize that's the case, because God has a job for us to do. Not sit and watch the world burn, okay? But recognize that it will get worse, okay? I love my relatives. They're so much fun. All right, here's what else it says. Verse 11. Oh, no, verse 10 still. But those who have insight, okay, none of the wicked will understand, but those who have insight will understand. Now, this is key. This is huge. Because what this is saying is that as the world is spinning and as it keeps heading towards the end, what it says is that those who are wicked will not understand. They will not note the signs of the times. They're not going to get it. But those who have insight, these are the same people that are talked about throughout the passage. These are the people that it says in verse 33 of chapter 11. Those who have insight among the people will give understanding to many. These are God's people. They're sharing the gospel. They're going, they understand. They've been strengthened by the word of God. These are those people. This is the church, even now, leading up, says they will understand that as it gets close to the end, the rest of the world is going to welcome it. They're not going to understand what they're ushering in, but the church will see and say, something's not right here. They will be able to recognize it. You will not be caught off guard. If you walk with the Lord, you will not be caught off guard and just welcome the Antichrist in. I've had people that have said, Pastor, I'm worried about getting the mark of the beast. I'm worried, you know, if they chip my animal, have I taken that on? Look, guys, I don't think it's going to be something that you're going to just find out later. You've taken it upon yourself. And now you've been marked, okay? I don't think that's what we're talking about. It's going to be one that the church will be, it will be extremely clear. You go down this road, and this is what that means. It is not a pleasant road to go down, and this is who's coming. You will recognize the times. Jesus even says this in Matthew 24. He says this, as the days of Noah were, so the coming of the Son of Man will be. In those days before the flood, they were eating and drinking and marrying and giving marriage until the day Noah boarded the ark. He's just saying, you know, before the flood came, people had no clue. They weren't listening. Noah was telling him and preaching to him. They didn't care. Life just went on as normal. And then he skips over in verse 44 and he says, this is why you are also expected to be ready, because the Son of Man is coming at an hour that you do not expect, meaning when Christ returns. So there's something that we should recognize is we will understand, we will see it clearly, before it happens, but those who don't will not. So just know, you should not be caught off guard. You will not take, if you belong to Christ, you will not welcome the Antichrist in and take his mark upon yourself. You will recognize what is going on and see it for what it really is. Okay, now here's how we finish up. Verse 11, from the time the daily sacrifice is abolished and the abomination is set up, there will be 1,290 days. Now, here's something interesting. It does appear in the text that it could be saying that there will be a third temple built in Israel. Right now, there is no temple. Right now, if you were to go to Jerusalem, all you have there is the Dome of the Rock. It's a mosque that sits where we believe the site of the temple was, because it was destroyed a second time. The Babylonians destroyed it the first time. That's why Daniel and all his friends are in exile in Babylon throughout the book. The second time is about 30 years after Jesus, 37 years after Jesus, the Romans come in and they wipe the whole thing out. And it's been destroyed for almost 2,000 years. It could very well be that saying before he comes, the temple will be back up in place. And then at some point, he's going to shut it off. Now, if you remember in Daniel, this gets a little tricky, so walk with me, stay with me, okay? If you remember in Daniel chapter 9, he talks about these weeks, the 77s, and he talks about everything that was going to happen all the way up until when Christ would come. We see this take place. The Messiah is killed in the 69th week. There is this big period of time that takes place. And then we get into that final week. The clock starts ticking again. For some reason, there's a huge gap of time, which I believe we're still in. We're in that gap right now. But at some point, the clock is ticking, and it tells us that what he would do is he would make an agreement with Israel, the Antichrist will. He'll make an agreement with Israel, and within 3.5 years, he cuts off that agreement, and then he's going to do something. He's going to make it very difficult for them. In the same way it was difficult for the Jews during the time of Antiochus in Hanukkah, it will be that much worse, even worse, is what we're told in chapter 12. Now, we find out that during that time, there was what was called the abomination of desolation. And what happened in that time is Antiochus came and set up a statue for Zeus in the temple. And they sacrificed pigs on the altar. That's why you've got the story of Hanukkah, which is called the festival of rededication. Meaning it took them time to rededicate, to get all the garbage out of there, to cleanse the place and get it ready again. Now, that's what he did. But here's what we're told will happen in the future. If, in fact, there is a temple, now it could be he's just saying he's just going to make worship impossible for people. He's not going to let people worship anymore. He's not going to let people follow or pray or congregate. It could be that, but it could be if there's a literal temple, it could be that what he's talking about is that you see this in Thessalonians, that the man of lawlessness will come and he will sit on the throne, place himself in the temple and claim to be God. Paul's writing about this in Thessalonians, saying that it's going to take place, that the man of lawlessness will come, and he will then tell everybody, I am God, worship me. And it seems like that's what's being said here, is that he will do. Now, it goes on to say that that's going to take place, and then it'll be 1,290 days. From the time he sits in there, declares himself God, has broken his covenant with Israel, it'll be 1,290 days before it gets better. Now, if you look at that, that's roughly talking about, 3.5 years of time, but there's about a 30-day period added on to that. And the speculation is Jesus comes at 1,260 days, and then 30 days is the administration or him judging the nations. And then you also see this weird phrase too, is happy is the one who waits for and reaches 1,335 days. And the speculation is that as he is judging the nations after he has come, it's taking place, but now he's setting up his kingdom. And after that period, it's done, it's over, and Jesus now reigns and rules everything. So, we're not quite sure, but this is one of the reasons why I think it's for the time of the end. I think for whoever's going through this in the future, it will all make sense, the days and all of that. Right now, we're still looking, and we would probably come to say, well, I got a follow-up question. I don't understand that either. But I think that's okay, because notice the response, right? At the end of these kind of confusing words, notice what it says. But as for you, Go on your way to the end. Not to the end of the days, but what is he saying? Go on your way to the end, meaning to your end, Daniel. Go on your way to your end. You're gonna go. You have an end, Daniel. You don't need to worry about that, Daniel. That's in the future, but you, Daniel, have an end coming for yourself. Then he says this, and you will rest. Meaning you're gonna die. You're gonna rest at some point. And then he says, and then you will stand to receive your allotted inheritance at the end of days. So he closes the book telling him this. Daniel, don't worry about that right now. You have a job to do, which is go on your way. Do what I've called you to do. And notice that when your time is up, you will be raised in the future to an inheritance. What is that? Well, look at chapter 12, look at 2 and 3, how this chapter started. Many will sleep in the dust, and the earth will awake, some to eternal life, and some to disgrace and eternal contempt. Meaning, Daniel, one day, when this is all said and done, you will then be resurrected. Your body will be resurrected. They'll pull old Daniel's body out of the Persian sand somewhere. If there's anything left to him, God will give him a new body and a new life and bring him. And then it says that, verse 3, those who have insight will shine like the bright expanse of the heavens, and those who lead many to righteousness like the stars forever and ever. Daniel, you don't need to worry about what's going to take place and how it all is. You've done your job. Keep doing what I've called you to do. And in the very end, I will resurrect you and give you what I've promised every person who follows me. Now that's fascinating, right? To think that, Daniel, don't worry about this. I got this. You just keep doing. So I want you to think about this as we close, right? I want you to think about, what does this mean for us? Right? Because there's still a part of us saying, well, when is it? I heard Mayan calendar starts tomorrow. It ends tomorrow. So is that the beginning of the 3.5 years? I don't know. And I'm not going to give you the answer to that. But if you were to ask the Lord that, what do you think he would say to you? Go on your way. You and I want to know all the answers, but Daniel's not given all the answers. You and I are not going to be given all the answers. In fact, it's very similar to how the book of Acts begins. Acts chapter 1, verse 7 says this, or verse 6. When they had come together, they, the apostles, asked him, Lord, are you restoring the kingdom of Israel at this time? They have just gone through the resurrection of Christ, and they say, Jesus, is this the time where you're finally going to reign? We're talking about the end of that tribulation, all of that. Are you here to reign now? Notice his response to them. He said to them, it's not for you to know the times or the periods that the Father has set by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come onto you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, to the ends of the earth. They want to know when, and he says, don't worry about that. You just do your job. And what is your job? Be my witnesses. You want to know what does God want you to do in light of knowing that the end is coming at some point, whether that's tomorrow, the 3.5 years starts, whether it's the start of nothing, or whether it's 100 years from now or 1,000 years from now. The same answer, I think, would be given to all of us. Go on your way, meaning do what I've called you to do. And for that, if you're a Christian, that means do the job God's called you to. In fact, let me show you something really fun. If you're a family with young kids and you've not gotten the Cornerstones book, this is what we do each week with our families. And during recap, we challenge our families in that small group time to do this as well. But I was reading with my kids this week, and the question comes up, why did God create Adam and Eve? And here's the answer that we started to flesh out and discuss. It says, God created Adam and Eve and all people to love him, to worship him, and to give him glory. Meaning, God created us so that we might know him, we might worship him, we might give him glory. Meaning, everything we do, we live for him. And so I think that's a perfect way to even try to encapsulate this. You want to know what you're supposed to do? What does go on your way mean for you? It means live for Christ now. Be like those people we see in chapter 12 who are shining for him now, telling other people about him now, and you will be strong when the end comes. If the end comes in your generation, you will be ready because you're doing everything you're supposed to do right now. Do not worry. Notice that he doesn't say, Daniel, the end is coming, and I need you to stock up on toilet paper and Clorox wipes and rice and beans like we all have. Like, because I'm holding on to my toilet paper. I'm just saying, I don't know what the Mayan calendar brings, but it probably ain't going to bring more toilet paper. I'm going to keep mine that I've got right now. But notice there's nothing in there physical he has to do to get ready for the end. No, you just do what I've called you to do. Go on your way. And so as we leave here today, I want you to think about go on your way. Glorify God who has made you, created you. Live for him now and accomplish. Be his witness even today. You know, it's the perfect time with Christmas now to be a witness for Christ, right? Because this is our holiday. The whole world is celebrating, whether they even know what it means or not, the whole world is celebrating Christmas. And so many times we could get lost in not really telling what the story is all about. We get lost in just the presents or Santa or all the treats and the movies and the traditions, but we have this incredible story to tell of what it's really about. I want you to think about this. Think about this. That one who hovered above the waters, who stood there, and Daniel fell weak in chapter 10 because he could not take seeing him for all of his glory, is the same one that at Christmas we light that middle candle to say, he's here. He came as a baby. The one who knew it all, controls all, will shut things off when he's ready and will come to reign, came as a baby. Why? Not to just be a baby and to live amongst us, but in order to live a perfect life so that at a cross, he would be punished in your place. At a cross, he would take all the punishment upon himself and give you his perfect record. You see, when you trust in Jesus Christ, you're not just trusting that he came so you could be a good person and do good things. You're trusting that the God of the universe came and lived a perfect life because you can't live it. I can't do it for one day, people. And yet he came and lived his whole life and at the cross was punished for what I did and for what you did. The God of the one who hovers over the water, he did that. He didn't have to, but he did it. So that you might go free. You can trust in him and say, God, save me. And what he does is he takes that nasty record of yours and gives you the perfect record of Jesus. So when you stand before God, when we read that judgment of chapter 12 that's coming, you no longer stand in your own record. You stand in his record. You stand in the man in the linen's record. Bright and shining because it's his and not your own that you will stand before God. What an incredible thing to think about. And when we celebrate Christmas and we think about this, not only do we recognize the job that he came to do to save us, but we also recognize that we're also waiting for him to return again. We can't tell the story without recognizing that he came, he lived, he died, and he is coming back to rule, and he will put an end to all evil when the time is right, and he will allow us, you and I. Why anyone would want that? He does, because we're treasured to him, and let us rule and reign with him in the future. That is open to any and everyone. If you've never trusted in Jesus today, that is open to you right now, and all you have to do is praise him and call out his name and ask him to save you and to change you and to now follow him for the rest of your life. And if you make that decision, I want to know about it. I want to talk with you about it. If you've made and you're watching it, we have a link in the YouTube video that you can click on. But make that decision today. And for the rest of you, after we leave here today, you got a lot of stuff to do this Christmas. Go on your way. Grow in the knowledge of the God who saved you and go. We talk about everything here. Grow to go. Grow in this and go on your way. Serve him and be a witness. Don't just live your life the way you want to do it. You belong to him. Be his witness in every way that you are. Glorify him in every place you go. Let me pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you for this incredible story. The way that we end this book is once again our focus on you. It's not about Daniel. It's not about the stories that he just went through and things that we can learn. But it's about the God of the universe who holds all things in his hand, is bringing all of the world to an end at some point, and you will come and reign. God, I pray that our people here at Royal Palms will be people who will be found in that kingdom, that we will be raised to a new life one day, not because of, not for the judgment, but because of the incredible blessing to reign with you because we stand in the record of Jesus. God, if there's anybody in here who's trying to do it on their own, trying to go on their own record, trying to live for themselves, hoping that if they were just a good enough person that they would make it in, God, I pray that today they would recognize the foolishness of that plan and the promise and the glory that comes with trusting in the finished work of Jesus Christ. God, as we celebrate Christmas today, I pray that we would recognize this is a story not of just about you coming and providing the ultimate sacrifice for us, but we also get to be excited about your second coming too, and to wait and trust in that. No matter how each day may come and have its own troubles, you are in control, and we call upon you to come, and we wait for you to reign. God, we thank you, and we pray these things in your name, Jesus. Amen. Ivy, will you lead us just a line or two as we sing? Guys, here's what I want you to do is respond now where you're at. Maybe some of you need to make that decision to follow Jesus today. Maybe some of you, it's just time to just get right with the Lord and say, maybe I haven't been living for him. Maybe I haven't been a witness. But let God work in your heart, tell you what you need to do. As Ivy sings, you can sing with her. Maybe you just need to pray, and then we'll close together in just a minute or so.
Jesus, you're the one who saves us. You're the one who saves us. King of all the other kings on earth. Jesus, you're the one who saves us. You're the one who saves us. King of all the other kings on earth. You have come to save us. You have come to save us. You have come to save us, O Lord. You have made a way here. You have made the way. You have come to save us, O Lord. And Jesus, you're the one who saves us. You're the one who saves us, King of all the other kings on earth. And Jesus, you're the one who saves us. You're the one who saves us, King of all the other kings on earth. King of all the other kings on earth.
One of the best ways you can be a start to be a witness right now, by the way, guys, is grab a card and point someone to just a service. We talk about one of our values here being invite. We say invite people to church, but invite people to a relationship with Christ. And sometimes those go hand in hand. It's not enough to just invite, but it's to church, but it's a start. And so invite someone to come with you to Christmas Eve. Spend a little time with them. Make them feel, because notice that's what we're called to do. That's how we go on our ways. We continue to be a witness for him. So use that card. If you need extra, we've got them in the office. One other thing.